off, and we're gonna go in 3, 2, 1, and.
That was
a different transition. Hello, and welcome to G3. We are a new show. I don't know. Do I keep saying new show? Because this is show number 6. I just got on the second hand. We're a relatively new show, a talk show, and we feature some women who are living and working within the tech field. Without any more delay, because we've delayed actually a day at this point, we had some scheduling difficulties because I've got really, really, really busy women who have very full lives, and we have scheduling problems. So anyway, here we go. Let me think. What else do I need to... What do we need to do? We need to... Did I want to say something first before I introduce? No, let's just introduce everybody. Okay, let's go to our studio shot. And I'm not sure why we're transitioning that way, but we'll just go with it today. Let me introduce. In the upper right is Mary Hodder. Hi, Mary. We were back to our Brady Bunch again. If you missed that show. Hello. Yeah, we had a Brady Bunch routine a couple shows ago. So if you missed that, you might want to recapture it. Okay. And we've got Denise Howell.
Hi ladies. Denise. Good to see you.
And Hallie Suit Tucker.
Hey, I'm here. It's very hot in Boston.
Ooh, hot in Boston. It's, well, depending on where you are around here, it may be hot or maybe not. Around me, not so much. So, hey, we just, Father's Day just happened, and, happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there, or all the moms who are fathers, because there's a lot of those. My mom was one growing up, so when when Father's Day rolled around, I felt a little melancholy, because I didn't really grow up with a dad at all. But my mom was my dad, and, I always thanked her on Father's Day. So, how about you guys? What did you do spending your Father's Day? Doing anything?
Ooh, I went hiking and cooked a bunch, but I wasn't with my dad, but my dad did, as he always does, regularly call me for tech support. And so we had some tech support on his laptop. And then he asked, of course, again, should I get an iPad? And I'm thinking, it would be easier for me if you got an iPad. Yes.
So the answer is yes. Yes. Denise, how about you?
We went to Utah just for a day.
Wow.
That's what my husband wanted to do for Father's Day. So we went over to Salt Lake City and then drove up to Park City, which is beautiful in the summertime.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of activities at Park City Mountain, slides and, they call it the Alpine Coaster, where you're going down the mountain in this sort of gravity-controlled roller coaster device where you do the braking. So you can decide how bold you're feeling that day, if you're going to just go all out or take a nice leisurely ride down the mountain.
Wow. How extravagant for Father's Day. That's just
it was
terrific.
Really cool. Yeah, it was spur of the moment. And unfortunately, it made me, because we were kind of just spur of the moment going out there, running back, and it all happened really quickly. On actual Father's Day, I forgot to call my actual father. I had to make that up the next day.
This is a problem. Yeah.
Yes.
That happens around here a lot, too. And mm-hmm. Hallie, how about you?
My dad was not around to celebrate with. He passed away. It's like 12 years or so. Mm. But I did grow up with him around. My dad was like kind of a Don Draper ad guy. So I grew up at a really weird growing up. He was really my business mentor. I totally loved to talk business with him. So I didn't do that on Father's Day, but I... actually, with my husband's dad, we planned a vacation to go down and see him in Florida, both his mom and his dad. So we're going to go down and see the in-laws, and they were thrilled, so that was really good. And I got in kind of one of these things on JetBlue on Twitter, trying to help me fix something that was a mess. And Twitter was like awesome. And they really, it was one of those things we talked about in other shows.
Yeah.
That I just went public with it and they totally delivered. And I was thrilled because long story that there had been a visit to the parents when my husband got sick, had laryngitis. We canceled his ticket in advance and we expected a credit. It never happened. So when we went to book this next one to see his dad, I said, wait a minute, what happened? And JetBlue, when I went on Twitter, was like, boom, right on it. It was great.
That's kind of cool to hear. And that's been my experience for most times that I've actually taken to Twitter to complain or just ask for help. So that's, I'm glad to hear that someone else is getting some support there too.
It works.
Yeah. Yeah. So, well, that's nice to hear. Sorry that you don't have your dad around, and I'm glad that you have other ways of memorializing Father's Day and dealing with that. So, you know, yesterday we were going to do a show, and I was kind of thinking that nothing was going on, and now today I think, like, a lot of stuff is going on. So, what's going on? Who wants to start?
I can start.
Okay.
Yeah, go.
Oh, but we're supposed to let Denise start because we always talk too much. So.
Okay, Denise.
You guys don't talk too much. I really don't, and I'll tell you why. This is the first week that my child is out of school, so I've been running around doing stuff with him and not paying attention to what's going on in the world, let alone the technology world. Right. So I'm feeling a bit out of touch right now.
That's totally fine because you should be a mom when you can be a mom first, right?
Yeah.
Right.
It's like summer camp time, isn't it?
It is. And he's got different camps throughout the summer, but this is a week when he doesn't. So it's just
the whole time and you can hang out with him.
Yeah, exactly.
That's great. That's good.
Yesterday we popped over to, because we live in Southern California, and Disneyland is just right around the corner. And the hysterical thing about that is, you know, it used to be, oh, great, you know, we'll go to Disneyland, we'll ride rides. And now it's like, you know, he's getting to the age where, really, Disneyland? Aren't I a little old? And I'm like, yeah, let's go to Disneyland.
Cool.
So, dragged him kicking and screaming to Disneyland, and we had a nice time.
Okay.
Sounds good.
Yes. Well, that sounds great to me. I'd like to have a Disneyland.
But, you know, like I said, I'm feeling a bit out of touch. So catch me up.
That's
if you
okay.
Would.
All right. Well,
can I tell you my story?
Yeah. Oh. Well, I want to say.
Go ahead.
Let me say one thing, and then since we're talking about families a little bit, I did notice Rebecca. Who? What is that, Denise?
What? Oh no, it's not a beer. It's terrible to drink these in a car because they bottle them in beer bottles or what looks like a beer bottle, and it's kombucha.
Tea. From here, it looked like a wine bottle. I was like, go for it, Denise.
Now, there's a local LA small kombucha company called Kombucha Dog, and every label has a rescue dog on it
that
is capable of adoption. So. Yes, I walk around town and in my car drinking these. I'm just waiting to be pulled over for.
It will happen at some point.
Yeah.
While we're talking about family for a moment, I think Rebecca brought up in our Facebook chat. We have a little Facebook chat with us on the show on our off time, and we throw ideas around. And Rebecca was noticing that Facebook now is allowing breastfeeding photos, which they did not before. And I just wondered, you know, really quickly what you all thought about it and, you know, yay, hey, or what?
I think it's good. I mean, why not? I always thought it was really weird that they didn't allow that. And then, of course, you know, you get bugged by some person that you don't know who's trying to just friend a lot of people because they're really just in the porn or whatever sex industry, and then they post all these racy photos, and it's like, how could that possibly be less of a problem than breastfeeding? I mean, it's, you know, I just thought it was really weird. It's like, of course, allow breastfeeding. Like, why not?
Yeah, it was really inconsistent, I think, with Facebook's positioning to not allow it, because they're so the vehicle that people use to share their family experiences exactly. with family and friends. And, you know, I can think of few more treasured family experiences when your child is young than, you know, all those little moments with them, including, you know, if you're one of the people who actually manages to pull that off, not everybody has a successful experience breastfeeding. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's part of your young life.
You moms, did you get a chance to breastfeed?
I did.
I did, and I didn't like it at all.
Oh.
And I had a lot of problems, and he was not gaining weight, so I had to go the complete other way. Mm-hmm. And everything I expected about birth was the opposite. So everything I thought would work, like, nothing worked the way I expected, but that was what I learned, is, like, nothing works the way you expect it. So that's okay.
Right. Well, I, for one, am really glad that, you know, this change has happened. I thought it was stupid to begin with. I think, you know, the people who don't get breastfeeding or want to sexualize it, I have absolutely
that?
No patience for them at all. I mean, it's like, this is the way to feed your child. If you can, if it's working for you, please. And, you know, the whole idea, I mean, even I sort of understand people when they say, you know, well, why don't you cover up a little bit? And I breastfed, and I think for other people covered up. Steve will tell you that in our home, or even when we just had a few people over at the house, I didn't bother covering up at all. I mean, I just, you know, you just take it out and there it is, feed your baby. So, I mean, it is a totally natural part of life. And the fact that Facebook is acknowledging that, I guess, at this point is a nice thing. But I think enough said about that, but I did want to acknowledge that Facebook, I think, is doing the right thing now.
It's cool.
It does kind of bring up sort of a meta issue for me around founders and companies, because I think a lot of times company culture, you know, even cultural decisions like whether to allow breastfeeding photos comes from the founders. And the founders of Facebook are young guys, right? And none of them had kids when they founded it, and I don't think any of them do now. And I bet if they had a kid that had a kid all along, that would have been a lot different, you know, that policy. But it is interesting. I have made the remark over the last, I don't know, decade or however long, that you can really tell how the founders feel about their users just if you look at the features in terms of how friendly they are or how accommodating they are to their target users. You can tell a lot about how they feel about their users. Mm-hmm. And it kind of feels like this sort of sat in that category, which is like, you know, that they weren't putting themselves in the shoes of, you know, women who are maybe over 25 years old, you know, that they weren't able to do that. And so, I mean, I'm glad that they've done it, but I also think, you know, it speaks a lot to, you know, having a diverse group of employees and founders in a company because you get a better product, you get a better company. And Facebook would have been better if they'd had maybe a more diverse group, and this wouldn't have been an issue.
I don't know. I'm not sure I agree with you that it was founder based or that the founders had a lot to do with it. I agree that maybe if you have some older, more experienced people that they might be looking at it differently. But I think it probably came down to this decency issue. And I have a feeling that that wasn't a founder issue, but, you know.
But it's what me. I mean is that you establish a company culture and then you pass that on to, you know, each group of employees that you hire, and they pass it along and they pass it along. And so you establish a tone, a vibe. And if they didn't understand people who weren't like them, you know, that vibe gets passed on. And so then they, you know, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
Where it's not that they made this exact decision, probably, but I mean, who knows, maybe they did, but I doubt it. But they created a culture that maybe was more, you know, young. It's so skewed young that they couldn't understand why it wasn't a sexualized thing to have a breast photo on Facebook, and why that's different from, you know, a sexualized, an actual sexualized photo. Like, they didn't see the difference.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's what I mean about the culture. Do you think that the software that they use to find out if people are doing porno pictures, like it's got a lot of pink or something, or breasts or shapes? I mean, maybe the software was the problem. Yeah, maybe the couldn't distinguish.
You do it with visual recognition software where if there's more than a certain percentage of skin in the photo, then it's likely porn or something sexualized. That's, you know, and then you pull those photos and then you have people review them and, you know, whatever. So,
well, that's
so maybe it was that.
Yeah,
could be.
It was probably hard to distinguish, and too much trouble to, and you know, more staff that had to make those decisions. Yeah. But as soon as there was a controversy about it, and there was one early on, that's when, you know, you get into Mary's founders issues and culture issues, that how you resolve those controversies says a lot about you as a company. The fact that the controversy existed in the first place maybe says something about initial decisions and software. But once you know that there's a cultural problem here, you either sweep it under the rug, which seems like they kind of did, or you address it you make it, you know, not an issue anymore. So it's good they finally did that.
Right.
Okay.
So, in other news, Amazon is having a launch event today, mm-hmm. and they are announcing, I think, the rumor is, I don't know if they've done it yet. I actually was just hunting around online.
They have done it.
They have done it. Okay. So, it did come out.
They have a phone?
It's a new phone, and I think it's based on the same similar code as the Kindle, which is based on
Android
and Linux. But it has some special sensors, and I have to disclose. So Ed is actually on the sensor team at Amazon. And so he's like, I can't tell you what this is, but there's a thing today. And I did part
okay.
of it.
Well, so, the phone is called Fire Phone. Mm-hmm. They have announced it. And we should be able to bring up some of the feature set. I know that there's either a live event happening as we speak, or it is just ended. I do know that, let's see here. I've got a couple notes, so let me... well, one thing that they're going to be offering with the phone is free unlimited, I think, photo storage. So cool. That is kind of interesting right there. We had been hearing rumors that there would be 6 cameras on the phone, a front, a back, and 4 in the corner, and the 4 on the corners were sort of like face recognizing instruments that would be able to tell when you tilt your head. Here, tilt your head. Or, and then when you tilt your head, you'd be seeing some other options, so that the menu, you know, you just need to sort of angle it yourself differently, or the phone differently, and you would be seeing other menu options and things. I'm not exactly sure. From what I read up to the point of the event, they hadn't talked much about the 3D sort of you know, tools or features of the phone, but that was what was the big rumor. Anyone else have some info about that?
Well, I first of all, I just have to say that I looked at Kif Leswing's article on GigaOM, and he says it's a beast. It's 4.7 inches. It's unique because it's so huge. Uh-huh. So it's kind of funny, and it's actually relatively cheap. I think it's $200 for a 32 gigabit model with a 2-year contract, so it's not, you know, that crazy, although that whole contract thing in America is, you know,
and
builds
I think
in a lot of costs.
I think
how does this work? It says it's available exclusively from AT&T, mm-hmm. and then you get the pricing that Mary just mentioned, but it says, I'm reading the Engadget piece, if you go off contract, you can get the phone for $649 for the 32 gig and $749 for the 64. But if it's exclusively from AT&T, how can you go off contract?
Yeah.
Well,
how can you activate it?
It's probably locked. And if you got it unlocked, and probably you can buy it on Amazon separate from the AT&T contract. I mean, I'm guessing wouldn't that make sense? Mm-hmm. It's Amazon, they can sell it.
But
yeah.
Who's your carrier then? So I mean, can you put it on another carrier?
If you unlock
well, maybe
it,
they'll sell it to you if you're outside the US. And then they give you the unlock code, and then, you know, maybe you could use it in Europe or something like that.
There was also some mention about the phone interacting with Chromecast so that you would be able to send your images or your video data through your phone to your TV.
Oh, that's smart.
Yeah.
Good Google partnership there.
It's a kind of Apple TV-ish, right?
Right.
So, yeah.
I think 13 megapixel camera.
Yeah, I think that's the... between the iPhone and other popular Androids, that's a big image, or clear image, however you want to term it.
Mary, free photo storage is going to get crazy if everybody takes.
Right.
Oh, I know. What does that remind you of? Reminds me of how when they launched the iPad and iPhone, you had the ability to have unlimited data, and then they had to say, oops, sorry, we really can't do that.
right.
Unlimited until you use it too damn much, and then we're going to pull it back.
Right.
Or unlimited until too many early adopters come in who are heavy users, like a Scoble, and then you end up with, so they generate buzz, and then they clamp down on it, you know.
Yeah.
Kind of unfortunate, but yeah, that's probably what will happen here.
Hey, Mary,
I asked you guys, who's a big Kindle user here?
Not I.
Not that much for me.
Okay, so I'm really into the Kindle. Mm.
I use it for things like camping.
This phone looks to me. It's like,
because here's the thing. You can be camping and you're in your tent and it's at night and there's no light and you can read because it's lit. You know, and so I have read whole novels camping with, you know, the Kindle Fire.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. The phone just doesn't look like anything interesting to me.
The Fire Phone? I like that they call it the Fire Phone. I feel like firefighters should use it and get around with it and, like, take pictures of the fire and upload them immediately, you know.
And you have to have a case that's like a Dalmatian.
I'm curious enough. I want to mess around with one, play with it, and see what it feels like.
Of all the features, what do you like the best?
I don't know. I mean, I'm just looking at this article. Amazon does a lot with sensors, and I know this just because Ed works on that. And so, you know, I'm curious about what they have done. You know, there's barometers in Kindles, and probably this, you know, also this phone, and there's altimeters, and I mean, like, an amazing array of sensors. And so I'm actually really curious about what they've done. My Android phone, my latest one, has a lot of that stuff too, but it's not really utilized in the phone. Like, there's not all that much that, you know, there's not all these interesting ways that the phone uses it, but Amazon's doing a lot with it for some reason. And I would love to play with it, this phone, and see like what is it doing with all the sensors? It's really, really different. You know, that is expanded.
Do we need to get Ed on the show and tell us all about the sensors that we need to do?
You know what he'll do? He'll say, "I'm not allowed to talk about anything that I'm working on."
Well, here's
I'm familiar with that phrase.
Yeah,
I think this is a sensor related paragraph from Engadget. Says the phone will ship with something called Firefly. It's a feature that uses the phone's camera to recognize books, DVDs, phone numbers, QR codes, CDs, URLs, games, barcodes, and more, and also uses the phone's microphone to listen to songs. If it detects an item, you can quickly tap a button to purchase it from Amazon, of course.
Of course.
It can recognize art. It pulled up a Wikipedia entry for cornflowers by Sergei Osipov. as well as Man with Red Hat by Vittore Carpaccio. So it's very artistic. And it recognizes over 100 million items, including street signs.
So, so are we to understand that you'd show the phone an image or something in the real world, right, and it's recognizing it, and then it's giving you feedback, basically, if you can buy it on Amazon, is that right?
Right. Or it's giving you information.
So you can buy like a one-way sign on the street. You could like shoot it and then Amazon would be like, buy this one-way sign.
It'll be interesting to see.
I need that feature.
What about, does it say anything about the camera?
It just says it's that sounds like it uses the camera and the microphone.
Okay.
As for the camera, there's a 13 megapixel rear facing one equipped with an f2.0 lens and optical image stabilization. It doesn't say anything about a front facing camera.
Yeah, the image stabilization is something that's relatively new, isn't it? I mean, I don't think we have a lot of image stabilizers in other phones, do we?
I think they're becoming more and more common. My son's Android phone has one.
Well, it sounds like a real interesting entry into the mobile phone market. I mean, I'm going to be interested to see it for sure. And yeah. Here's a big thing. Okay. Ooh. Okay. Maybe I'm breaking some news. So Steve Gilmer says to me, I think I'm going to get an Android phone.
Is that breaking news?
And start using it. I know.
That's big.
Okay, so I just want to comment on the photo of Jeff Bezos, and so he's got the big giant images of the phone, and then it says Fire behind his head up on the screen, and then you know he looks, it's like the Jeff Bezos version of Steve Jobs.
Yeah,
and of course he's holding the phone. It's totally like, did Steve Jobs set the presentation vibe or what? I mean, because Jeff Bezos is just,
exactly.
So he has a button-down shirt, but otherwise it's all exactly the same.
Fortunately, he's wearing his pants at the proper location on his waist. Jobs was always a little high.
Yeah, he would wear them like mom jeans or something. But but that's because Steve Jobs came from a slightly earlier era when high-waisted pants used to be in like 20, 30, whatever long ago. And it's like he never changed his uniform.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of men's appearance, okay, I we're talking tech here, but I've got a break for a second, gals. Here's a pet peeve of mine. It's been going on for some time. I need to start a campaign. I need you to help me. Here it is. Paul McCartney, please show us some gray hair. Please, dear God, where is your gray hair? It is time.
He's got a lot of wrinkles.
What?
Maybe he doesn't go gray.
Like if you look at recent photos, my dad very wrinkly.
Didn't go gray till he was really old.
No.
Same with like my husband's dad.
No, Hallie. No. Look at his hair. No, it's got that color that kind of like, I'm dyeing my hair. I don't want to go gray.
Oh.
And how old is Paul? He's got to be near 70.
Oh, he's got actually his birthday is today.
Oh, happy birthday, Paul!
Happy birthday,
Paul McCartney. Okay, this is a perfect day to talk about this. Paul, please, I beg you. He has to have at least a little gray at the temples. I don't believe that someone doesn't have any gray hair at almost 70.
Hey, time out.
Yeah.
None of us dye our hair. We have nothing to say.
Yeah, yes, we all probably dye our hair.
I actually have some if you want to see.
I am not talking about women. I'm talking about men right now.
That's what I'm talking.
There we go. Yes, a friend of mine was sort of going prematurely gray and was having troubles keeping on top of keeping the gray out of her hair. So she just let it go, and now she's very silver, and she inspired me. So I stopped. You're going to see me go grayer and grayer.
Wow. I'm stopping. I want to go. I miss the gray. Talk about Father's Day. Like my father had a big gray streak. I was thinking I miss it. It's like I get to remember what he looks like. So I'm going sort of gray. We're seeing what happens.
I am definitely letting the gray and start to mix in with the blondes. So the blondes that I am throwing in I'm getting them more grayy color so that when, you know, because I don't do it that often. I'm not good about going to the hairdresser often. So I'm definitely letting my gray sort of integrate.
Yes.
That's what it's called. Yes. Integrate. Yes. With my blonde.
I think that's a new thing.
Yeah, yeah, but
I've
so
been all my life highlighting my hair, and now that I have quote unquote natural highlights coming in, I'm just embracing them.
Yeah,
yeah, I think it's better.
My mom started doing that, and it's kind of refreshing because I didn't think that she would, and now she's sort of, she's got a really pretty gray color, and but okay. She started going gray in her 20s.
Ah, well,
so you know, but she's kind of had it with, you know, the hair coloring and everything. So she's finally embracing it. But, you know, but I'm talking about Paul McCartney, yeah, because I think there's all these
one picture, Tina, where he looks like he at least has gray sideburns a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
the photo I just posted. I put it on our G3.
Oh,
thing
you
on
did.
Facebook.
He's showing
and
a little gray.
Got gray at the temples, you know, or at the sideburn.
That's a little new. I'm sorry. That's a little new. And
I
I'm glad
talk about
to see
another
it.
Hair thing.
Yeah.
I hate this, like, no hair, guys, I'm an athlete, I'm so cool guy thing. Nobody's bald anymore. Really? Everybody's just shaved. What?
I was shaved. That?
You mean the shaved look, that thing?
It's not. It's stupid. I
it
hate
is
it.
Hot. It's totally hot. I love it.
I oh, three words for it. You, Hallie. Jean-Luc Picard.
Yeah.
Sexy.
Totally. haven't you heard the song Bald Headed Men?
It's a lot of VCs do it.
Mm. Oh, well, if you're a VC, that would not be good.
Okay, so
what? What is that? They're trying to look like they're a basketball star? What? What is that?
Okay, from VC baldness or shavedness to something else. Okay.
Oh, all right, I'm going to have to post the Bald Headed Men song to the G3 thing on Facebook because it's a rockin' song and they do mention Jean-Luc Picard.
So before we stop talking about the new phone from Amazon, you remember, Mary, how there was a controversy when the original Kindle Fire came out about the Silk browser? And there were a couple of controversies. There was one thinking that Amazon was going to be spying on your browsing.
Right.
And then there was another, I think, relating to do not track, that your ability to turn that off was buried deep in settings.
Yeah.
Or maybe there they are the related
right now.
Thing. I don't. I'm assuming the phone's going to have the Silk browser. I'm wondering how it's going to handle
I don't
privacy.
Know, and we should totally look at that and report back next week.
Yeah, there's a lot to look at.
Well, I did read that these phone sensors can tell if you're what race you are, what gender you are, a few different things, and I'm sort of curious as to how they're going to be using that information.
Yeah.
Okay, what else? So, and the name, didn't you say something about Firefly? That was the first phone I got my little daughter.
Yeah, that's
it was
what
this
I thought.
Blue phone and it had like two buttons on it. You could either call mom or
that's
like 911 or something. Or I think you could program a few buttons, but it just, you know, one, two buttons. It was perfect for, and she was really young at the time. It was ridiculously young, but it was called Firefly. It was cute. And it had a little, one of those little carabiners like attached to it, and you could just like clamp it onto her bag, and it was a very cute thing. I missed that little phone. Now she's all, you know, I gotta have the latest, so she gets it. What can I say?
Hey, I wanted to ask if you guys want to. I have some like crowdfunding update I wanted to talk about, if that's of interest.
Encourage that. Let's hear what is going on.
So I did a Kickstarter program in 2012, and it was for writing my book, and it went off. It was successful. It wasn't one of these mega crazy Amanda Palmer who made $10 million ones, or the Pebble Watch that asked for $100,000 and got $3 million. It was just, I needed about $15,000. I got $16,000. It was all good. But at that time, Kickstarter was pretty new. And people just were very helpful to each other, just kind of sharing information about how to do Kickstarter, how to promote your Kickstarter, very, very casual and friendly. I'm now working at a startup in, it's based at MIT, and we launched like 2 days ago, and we're bombarded by all these, well, let me help you promote your Kickstarter services. So all these people have created businesses around promoting Kickstarter projects, and there's just like a whole new level in crowdfunding of these sort of a, it's becoming a professionalized or something. So, and the many of these people, I'm working as chief marketing officer for this company, and so the boss continues to send me these, and many of these people are, I'm going to help you promote your thing on Twitter or on whatever. I go and I look, and they have like 12 followers, and I got whatever 3,000 because I've been there a while, and they are like, I just wonder, who are these people? What are they doing?
Yeah,
and they charge you a percentage of a program. Like if you make X, you pay them 3% allegedly to connect with media and promote this all over and whatever. Yeah. It just seems kind of strange. Together with those are like the partners I kind of don't want to partner with. Then there's another group that we are working with whom people I really like. They've figured this side out, that they will document and kind of, they really work over your business plan, go into detail, and try and figure out, can you really get this thing manufactured? Because the dirt behind Kickstarter is that many things that you, they say they're going to manufacture, they never manufacture, in fact, or they have just big problems. Mm. Our startup has 2 Chinese founders who have done manufacturing in China. So I think that's a big plus. And so this group's called Dragon Innovation, unrelated to Dragon speech recognition software that you might know. But Dragon actually works through your project with you, and they don't certify you unless it's clear you can make and deliver the thing. So anyway, I just wondered, you know, when I started Kickstarter, there were, you know, Indiegogo was just starting. Now it's pretty mainstream. I think there's Rocket Hub. There's a number of crowdfunding. There's a lot going on. And I just wonder, have you guys been hearing about it? What do you know? And like that.
Well, my information about crowdfunding is maybe limited. I haven't done one myself, but I looked into doing one heavily, and I'm on the board of a nonprofit that's looking at doing one. My sense is that that you do, at this point, if you're going to do a large project, maybe over, I don't know, 25 or 50K, you do need to do a lot of marketing lead prep. In other words, you basically have to be posting and engaging every day, which means developing materials for weeks ahead of schedule, so that you're constantly, you know, giving people new things, and, you know, you're hitting thresholds that make other potential funders excited, and then they come in and give you some money. So there's that. And then the other thing is, the interesting thing for me when I did budgets for doing a crowdfunding thing is if you're a for-profit, you have to factor in either spending all the money or paying taxes on it by the end of your calendar year, whatever your tax year is. And if you're a nonprofit, you have to also factor in all of your fulfillment. So if you promise a t-shirt with everything over, you know, $50 and stickers for everything over 10, and, you know, the product, whatever that is, the hardware, like for everything over, let's say, $100 or $200 or $500, and then, of course, you have to give basically, with credit card stuff at 4% and Kickstarter at 5%, you got to give 9% to Kickstarter. So just right off the top, minus 9%. And then you have to do all the fulfillment. And then you have to pay people to do the fulfillment if you sell a lot, right? So if you've got 5,000 t-shirts, you're not going to be stuffing those envelopes yourself, or you'll be dead and you'll never get it done. And so you have to factor in all these costs. And so in my view, what it ends up being is 50% for all that other extraneous stuff, and then the other 50% actually makes whatever you're going to make, software, hardware, I don't know, whatever it's going to be, some people make wallets and, you know, I don't know, just little low-tech items, you know. Right. Certainly there's a lot of Kindles for that, or books or whatever. But whatever it is, you know, if you do a lot, if you promise a lot, you have a lot of fulfillment. And so
Right. Your
budget, 9% for the cost of getting there, and then, you know, 41% to actually fulfill is pretty reasonable. And then maybe some marketing costs as part of that 41%, right, to get you the money. But then 50% should be for your project. And it's not just like, oh, we posted this thing and we got $1 million and then we had $1 million to spend. It's
exactly.
Like, if you raise $1 million, you know, $90,000 is going to Kickstarter, like right off the top. Mm. And then you have, you know, $900,010, you know, $910,000. And then what are you going to do? Well, what if you have $400,000 in marketing and fulfillment costs? Well, now you've got $500,000. I think this is why so many projects are late, or Right. They don't really fulfill, or they give you a really reduced version of whatever it is because they don't factor this stuff in. And then Yes. If you're a for-profit, I met with a tax attorney on this, and he was like, you better be prepared to either, you know, spend the money or pay like, you know, a lot of taxes.
So it's the economics of Kickstarter, and it's not maybe not the the promise of getting away from, you know, investors who are on your you know, breathing down your neck all the time. You've got something else breathing down your neck all the time,
right? You know,
which is you've these, got a profit margins. Yeah. Profit margins start to shrink. But Hallie, I'm not really sure that you actually told us what the product is that you're involved. We started talking about the business of, you know, Kickstarter environment, but what about this particular product? I'd kind of like to hear about that.
Okay. I don't want to make it a commercial, but it's a cool thing.
A little one.
Some guys at MIT, PhD in physics, and, you know the kind of guys we hang out with. So it's like Boston's
smart guys.
Silicon Valley kind of thing. And they have created a way for you to take think in the general area of like HomeKit, right? Mm-hmm. You have a way to use your cell phone and you can cue up music with light in your room. So you can put a party playlist together and you put music that matches that. You could, Denise, if you had a little baby, I know your guy is big now, but mm-hmm. you could put lighting that makes the baby go to sleep and have your playlist of lullabies coordinated. And it's also particularly in LED lights. You have color, very mm-hmm. colorful LED lights. It's called Bell LEDs, Bell LEDs, and it's like Bell Beautiful and LED like LEDs. So it's a clean energy, safe energy thing. They won this great prize at the MIT Clean Energy Award, People's Choice. It sounds like, you know, they won the Nickelodeon Award or something. I love it. And they're a cool team, and it's been fun to do this. And it's all over my page. You'll see it on my page. So I don't want to do too much of ad, but I love the team, and of course they should have had months and months of marketing. I started like last week, and we launched Monday.
So you have
anyway,
to do a college tour.
I think it always happens. But I want to ask Denise about: have you heard any from a legal point of view, people being really pissed off if they got scammed by? You know, a Kickstarter. And also I asked Scobel to put it on his page and he's like, all those Kickstarter things are a scam. So from the other Gilmore gang, we have Scobel saying it all stinks. But that's why having somebody like Dragon to certify, to distinguish which ones are scams and which ones are good, is this is part of the evolution of this, I think.
So you're saying Dragon is sort of the trustee of your crowdfunding project?
Yeah, it becomes like a good housekeeping seal of approval, which is legit. I think people want to know if it's legit.
Wait, yeah, so definitely. Trustee is certifying Kickstarters?
No, I was saying Dragon is like that.
Oh, right. Dragon is like, okay, got it. Oh, all right, I see. So you're just comparing them to Trustee.
Yeah.
Because I don't trust Trustee, and I've never trusted them. I really don't. It's, you know, the problem is that it's too easy to spoof a trust mark like that. It's too easy to, you know, mess around and basically try to buy people's goodwill. The stakes are too high, you know, for people to not try to game it. So, I don't know.
You've hit on something.
The dragon thing might be cool because it's humans.
Yeah. I think, you know, as more and more people turn to crowdfunding, and I think it has become mainstream, that it started out as sort of a geek way to raise funds for, you know, that gadget you've always been dying to make, or a piece of code that you've always envisioned. Well, hello. It looks like
I have Caramel.
I didn't even know she came in here. Hi. And now, you know, people are raising funds for all manner of things that have nothing to do with technology. And so that leads to a number of considerations. Number one, whatever your project is, it's harder to get attention for it. There's a lot more noise.
Yeah.
And two, you're going to get a whole range of ethics involved in the people who are seeking funding. You're going to have more and more problems on the legal front, false advertising claims,
But actually, the thing about the legal agreement with Kickstarter and Indiegogo, because I read both of them, is that when I was thinking about doing this, is that there's no accountability. There's no requirement that you do anything with the money once you get it. I mean, they want you to do updates and they want you to fulfill what you're doing, but they don't check on you. They ask you to do updates. But once they actually hand over the funds, which happens a couple of weeks after the thing closes, you know, that's it. And I mean, they even have rules like you're not supposed to buy property with your, you know, you're not supposed to raise money to, let's say, buy a house. But if you did raise a bunch of money and say, well, screw the, you know, special bike system that I said I was going to make, I'm buying a house, who would know, right? Because they just put the money in your account and that's it. And the problem is that there's no community way really either for people to have accountability other than, you know, they could tweet about it, they could blog about it, they could say something, but, you know, there's not that much that really can be done.
Why doesn't Kickstarter care more about, care's not the right word, but why aren't they overseeing the fulfillment? Doesn't it bode better for them if people are fulfilling? And why isn't there more checking and sort of coordination?
I think the assumption is that first of all, if there have been bogus pitches, and they've pulled them down before the end of the thing. Mm-hmm. So that's one piece. But then let's say you make it all the way through and you really are sincere, but you blow it or you totally underfund and you're not able to fulfill or whatever it is. I mean, they're relying on the people doing the pitching to accurately pitch and to follow all the rules. And as long as they think you're following the rules, they're not going to kick you off before the ending. And then once they give you the money, they're expecting you to do it. And I don't know how they would really follow up. It would take a huge amount of staff and oversight. Right. And what would they do? Claw back the money? If you've spent it, it's gone. I mean,
But maybe something like what eBay does, a kind of rating. I mean, I guess you're not necessarily doing repeat Kickstarter projects, but... here's our gardener. Isn't that nice? Now we're going to have some lawnmower sound. Perfect.
Hey, lawnmower.
You know, can I add one thing? I have some weird facts I got to throw out here, which is that the most successful Kickstarter programs have many videos with cats in them. What was it? It was so weird. It's like blown my mind. Wait, I have to remember in a minute. But that the cat thing is essential. Yeah, but to your point, Tina, about rating and trust and, you know, having sort of a, not a verified profile, but one where people have, you know, endorsed you and said, yeah, these are good folks. You do need a history in order for that to build up. That's why it works on eBay and something like Airbnb. But a lot of people, you know, their Kickstarter campaign is their single shot or their first shot at trying to get money. And so they don't have a history. Indiegogo, actually a lot just, of repeat it bears noting that the rules on Indiegogo are much looser for what sort of things you can do with the money. And if you have, I don't know if you can buy a house, if you can raise funds to buy a house, but if you could do it, it would be on Indiegogo and not Kickstarter.
So my other weird fact, I remembered weird fact number two. One of the biggest money makers on Kickstarter, you'll never believe this, are these paper board games, like with a lot of cards, and it's paper. Yes. It's not technology.
Really? Yeah, like what's the one? I did one. I paid for one, and I got the card. It's those cards, the Cards Against Humanity.
Cards Against Humanity.
It's awesome. I love those cards. And so they did a Kickstarter. They've done a few. And probably also because they did the first one and it was successful, they've done like 8 more. Right. And they have amazing themes. And then you get like 30 cards and you get a little special art thingy for your cards and it goes with the rest of your box of Cards Against Humanity.
I have my number 3 idea. My interesting number 3 Kickstarter fact is that there's been now a lot written about the fact that VCs must be the laziest people in the world. They're going to many of the crowdfunding sites to like take the low-hanging fruit and find companies to invest in. And I know Brad Feld from TechStars, there was a long article and he verified this is something that people are doing, that they're getting, you know, when they see something like the Pebble watch, you know, exploded, and it's now 2 years ago on Kickstarter, and now at a Target store near you, they are like really going there. I don't know if VCs, where else they're looking for new businesses, but they're definitely looking to crowdfunding.
It seems to be an easy way to sort of rifle through a lot of ideas, maybe pick up some trends, and, you know,
It's really analysis. Validating if customers pay in advance, like, and then if you give the next round of funding, I mean, you've already got something validated in the market,
right? And like you can see very well from the video if the people present well, if they've got, you know, their heads on straight.
Yeah.
Okay. And the other thing is, if you're doing the Series B in effect, and if Series A was the Kickstarter, all that money that went in, while there was supposedly, you know, there probably is some kind of fulfillment. Certainly for the Pebble watch, they sent all the money back out, you know, developing the watch and then sending it out as fulfillment. But basically, you just got a company with a whole bunch of customers and they've been validated. But now, you know, the first round of funding, it's not like you have to share a percentage of the company. You're the only VC in the game. I mean, how cool is that if you're a VC, right?
Right. It's like been vetted and it's been prototyped. You're seeing the team can work together. You're seeing everything they want to see. You're seeing the team works together. The product works. People want to buy the product. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, you know, it's a VC wet dream.
Oh my God. There we go.
That would be the show title. Go.
It wouldn't be G3 without some sort of interesting language.
and we
count on Hallie for that. So Hallie, keep it up.
We started out with breastfeeding and we're hopefully not.
Sorry, just couldn't resist.
Hot in Boston.
So, I cannot believe this. They're actually, the gardeners, they sound like they're throwing rocks at the door now. It's like the I just can't win today. Wow.
Do you pay them extra for that?
Yeah. I do. I pay them extra for that.
That's exactly right. Rock massages.
So amazingly, we're getting pretty close to our hour mark, and we were trying to keep this rein this show into an hour. An hour. We know that a few of us have some important appointments to get to too. So let's start to round up. Is anything else that we super need to talk about? I mean, I think we missed a few. Slingshot is happening with Facebook going after Snapchat. Snapchat's got some new kind of like crowd feature that's sort of interesting. Hallie's waving.
I'm waving. Is Google I/O out in the Netherlands of that wild area you guys live in coming up sometime, or is it already over?
I think it's next week. No?
Is it next week or did it just happen? There was some mention of Google I.O. and something I read yesterday, and I couldn't tell from the article.
June 25th through 26th.
Okay. All right.
See, I live here, but I know.
25th through 26th. Okay. Yes. Yeah. So it's coming up. That should bring us lots of information, I hope, to talk about. Something to chew on.
How Google's not doing Google Plus or Glass anymore.
Yeah.
Do you think they're going
to
say that?
No, I'm just making a joke.
Yes.
Well,
I have one thing I want to mention.
Yes.
And that is this. I posted those three articles, and I'll throw them up on our Facebook page. But the New Yorker had this article called "The Disruption Machine," which Jill Lepore wrote. And she basically criticizes some of the techno-utopia of Silicon Valley and also Clayton Christensen's, you know, The Innovator's Dilemma and all the disrupt kind of stuff that comes out of that. Everything from, you know, disruption classes and disruption degrees. Like at USC, you can get a degree in disruption. which I did not know about until I read this article. And then one of my former professors, Larry Downs, has a blog in Forbes where he talks about the Big Bang disruption.
Oh, he has a book. And so, a whole book on the topic.
Yeah. So, you know, he's always writing books. To be honest, I don't.
Hey, wait. Did you guys
up in the morning and there's a new book?
Did you read it?
All at once. Okay.
Oh, sorry.
Everyone talked all at once for a second there. So, okay.
Well, so Mark Andreessen wrote this tweet where he said, "Why hasn't anyone invented a robot that will write anti-technology essays for East Coast literary magazines? Come on, let's get on it." And so, in Salon, Andrew Leonard wrote this thing where he says, you know, actually, she's talking about, you know, she's this. Jill Lepore in the New Yorker is actually making, she's not anti-technology. In other words, what he's saying, is that she's critically reviewing some of the, you know, the techno-utopianism that we have here. Yeah. And, you know, and I have to say that, I just want to read this one sentence or two from the article, which I thought was awesome. It's possible to be critical of the way Silicon Valley is agitating for regulatory reform that's designed to nurture Silicon Valley business models without being anti-technology. It's possible to explore the question of how the current pace of technological innovation is affecting jobs and inequality without being anti-technology. It's even possible to love one's smartphone and the internet while at the same time critiquing run amok, change the world hype. I just thought it was really well done.
Yes.
Because in Silicon Valley, you're either, it's like, if you're not 100% with us, you're against us, you know, and exactly. It's like the world is more subtle than that. And so I wanted to throw it out there. I'll throw the links up on our thing, but good. I definitely recommend reading these two articles because I think we need to get, I mean, the whole point of this show and Gilmore Gang and other discussions is to get more into, you know, the subtle distinctions and not just be either, wow, it's all awesome. Oh my God, it's Google Glass. It's totally awesome. Mm-hmm. Or, oh, we hate it. You know, you're a glasshole. Like, really, that's the only two things? I think we can have a more interesting discussion. So I felt like when I was reading this, I was like, yeah, that's the reason we're doing this show, is because we want to talk about things in a more, you know, the read between the lines. Yep.
You know, and I see that there's some more humor coming out in our area. And when we start to be able to laugh at ourselves, I think this is totally healthy and good for us. And ooh, she's got the shades on.
It's the I gotta go shade.
It's the cool shade, seeing it almost time to go. So let me thank you all, Mary, Denise, and Hallie. Thanks so much for being here, even with all our scheduling craziness. You guys are awesome. I love talking to you every week. And when I think about not doing the show one week, I get a little sad because I like this time that we're sharing together. And I think we're creating something interesting here. At least, you know, at least for us, it's lots of fun. And I think I do want to share that the feedback that we've been getting has been really very positive. And we've been getting some like little technical feedback that's been helpful that we're going to implement. And so, you know, for people to find our shows and track our shows better. So we're listening, and we thank you all. We thank you all for tuning in and finding us. And we encourage some feedback. Find our Facebook page. I think I've got, let's see, do I have something I can show you? Yeah, there's the Facebook page. Okay. Let's wind this up. I'd like to... I've thanked you all. Thank you for being here. I want to thank Ustream for their support, New Tech for this fab TriCaster that I work with. It's a cool machine, and Philip Nelson, you're a cool guy, and Salesforce for their support, and my producer. Hey, that's me. see, Steve thanks me on his show, but I get to thank myself on this show. It's crazy. Yeah.
Hey, we thank you too. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Tina.
Oh, okay.
Awesome work.
Thank you. I'll take a bow. I'll just remind you all to step outside your comfort zone and go out and go do something good and come back and talk to us about that. And maybe we'll give you some ideas of how to do that soon. So this is G3 signing off, and everybody can, let's see, we'll get that shot in, and everybody can say bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Have a great week.